Just how much I really needed you. More than a friend, someone I could talk to. You changed me in so many ways. Nobody knows me like you. Put your arms around me, bring me through. There's many times I don't know what to do. Though some know me well, still nobody knows me like you. Each time that I slipped and fell, all of my faults, yes, you know them well. But you never turned me away. No, no, no. Nobody knows me like you. Put your arms around me, bring me through. There's many times I don't know what to do. Though some know me well, still nobody knows.
picture-perfect garden. While the sun went down, you could hear the sound of a man and woman crying, saying, what have we done? We made our choice and now we're dying, and we've got to leave this place and hide from God's face. But this is where we belong.
Good morning, church. It's good to see you this morning, gathering together to worship us. Good morning to those of you who are watching us on Facebook. I'm excited that you're tuning in to us this morning. I hope that you'll sing with us and worship the Lord with us together this morning. So let's all stand to our feet. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time to worship.
Alas, and did our Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by receive my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done, he groaned upon the tree? Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well might the sun in darkness hide and shut his glories in, when Christ the mighty sin. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. The drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Away, 'tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Let's go back to that chorus one more time, brother.
Do it. Amen.
Got to go back to the chorus one more time. Let's slow her down.
At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Y'all give the Lord a good hand. Amen. Bless you. You be seated this morning. Hey, it's a funny relationship between pastor and music director. I remember somebody saying years ago, Pastor Ron, you think you're the most powerful guy in church. I said, I didn't say that. He said, I know you're not. And I said, how? He said, well, the music director walks out and just does this, and everybody stands. You have to beg and plead, and he does that, and they sit down. So thank God for our worship pastors. Amen. Amen. Hey, if you have your bulletin, let's look at a few things real quick. Some big things coming up in the life of our church that you need to be aware of. Hey, next Sunday will be a special call business meeting. We had a little blooper. Your pastor forgot. We have two men, one to be ordained as a deacon, one to officially roll into an active service. And the church hasn't taken official action. Of course, it's been during COVID. We haven't been meeting. So we will introduce those guys to you at the end of the service, and then we will vote next week. Those guys are Ron Hall and Lewis Kennar. So pray for them. Pray for their families as the Lord adds them to our servant team here at First Baptist Center Store. And we appreciate all that these men have done and all that they will do in the future. Hey, some things here about CS Kids. We will be having our trunk or treat, and possibly that may be changing to a full-fledged meeting rather than that. So pray for that October 30th. Backpack, Christmas collection up, all that's on the foyer out there. Hope you'll go by and do that. Hey, if you would like to work in the coffee cafe over here, see Miss Tracy. Where are you? Is she in here? She's still out there. See Miss Tracy Smith. She's doing that for us now. And if you'd like to help serve, that's a great ministry. We're actually, the deacons have voted, we're actually helping and ministering to two particular ministries now, Show Save a Life and Room in the Inn. So if you'd like to be a part of that, hey, go by, see Miss Tracy. She'll be able to put you on the rotation list and do some things. Hey, pray for our search committee. We did vote last week to officially ask Ashley Bunch, Jimmy Howard, Jonathan Johnson, Louis Kennard, David Marcoux, Jeannie Nichols, Stephanie Owens, Elena Pettis to be our pastor search committee. So they'll begin that process. Pray for them as God leads, guides, and directs them. Did I get that right?
It's okay. It's all right.
I did say pastor, didn't I? Did. I'm not leaving. Youth preacher. I say that. By the way, the first week I said youth. I said pastor search committee. Some people started singing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And so, hey, I got a good word for y'all this morning. I can prove that it is more spiritual to be an Auburn fan than an Alabama. I can prove it. If you're an Auburn fan, you have to pray a whole lot more. Would you agree? Would you agree? You have to have a lot more faith. And I promise you this, you're a lot more humble. So it's a lot more biblical. So, hallelujah. Hey, hey, a sad note. Many of you may have got our calling post. Miss Natalie McDonald's son, Nicholas Tackett, was killed Friday on a motorcycle accident. His funeral services will be here Thursday, 2 p.m. So please pray for Natalie, Darwin, and the whole family. I hope they're listening today. I'm sure they are. We're praying for you guys. We love y'all, and we're so, so sorry. Our hearts are with you today and our prayers and the love of the Lord Jesus. He has two daughters, and so we're praying that God would give them grace during this time, all right? Hey, also pray for Brandy and Jesse. They both have COVID, and Brandy is 5 months pregnant. So there's some concerns there. Miss Louise came home, didn't she? So we praise the Lord for that and ask the Lord to do that, okay? Hey, if you're here today and you're our guest, we're thankful to God that you're here. We've got a great crowd. Would y'all thank the Lord for any of our guests that's on campus today? Amen. Remind you as you leave today, please be nice to people and let them know you're glad they're here because somebody may be praying about coming and serving and being a part of our services. So do that today. Hey, let's pray. And boy, was that a good song this morning or what? That was just sweet. But I'm excited. I've heard a little bit of what they're going to do today. You're going to be blessed. I'm excited about the message. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste. Do you have blessed assurance? Well, I hope today you'll find that in the scripture. Father, we love you. We praise you. We bless you. We pray for all these things from October trunk or treat to our ordaining and electing new deacons to our backpack ministry. God, there's a lot of functioning things going on in the life of our church. We pray you would bless. But we just stop to remember that we have brothers and sisters who are going through the valley of back of the valley of tears. We pray for Natalie and Darwin. Pray for that dear wife, for those two daughters. God, we pray that your hand would be with them and upon them on this day. And I want them to know that this body is praying for them. So God, give them grace. And may we be able to minister during the time of the funeral. Father, we love you and we thank you for grace. That gives us assurance that it's not human or earthly, but it's divine and heavenly. So God, remind us of that today as we study your word. We love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. And all the church said, amen. Let's worship, Pastor.
My lady down, I'm not my own. I
pride, giving up all my rights. Take this light and let it shine. Take this light and let it shine. I lay me down, I'm not my own. I belong to you alone. Lay me down, lay me down. Oh, hand on my heart, this much is true. There's no life apart from you. Lay me down, lay me down. Oh, lay me down, lay me down.
Lay me down.
It will be my joy to say your will, your way. It will be my joy to say
my life as a sacrifice.
Darkest night,
I can sing in the troubled times, it says. I can sing when I win. You know, we're going to win, folks. I don't know if y'all read the back of the book, you know, the last chapter right before the maps. We're going to win. I can sing when I lose my step. Do that a lot, brother. Anybody else in here lose your step from time? Mm-hmm. I can sing because he picks me up. I can sing because I know he's there. And I can sing because I know he hears me when I call out to him in prayer. That's what the song's about. Why do we know that? Why do we know that?
Because the Bible tells us
so. And how is it possible? Because of the blood. The blood of Jesus. That's why it's possible. Because the blood of Jesus, not only does it wash us over, but it fills us. And because it fills us, we can sing. No matter what's going on. No matter what's going on, we're going to go back to old school. We're just going back to old school, little country Bible church in the country. And just sing something we know. So some of y'all are looking at me, even though the songs are on our webpage every week, so you'll know what we're going to sing, and I know you don't listen to them anyway, but that's okay. Some songs you know because you've been singing them all your life and because you've sung them in the hard times. And you've seen how God has brought you through, and you've sung these songs in the good times because you're reminded of what he's done for you. These songs go back years and years and generations, some of them even, because he loves us. And his blood, oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. That washes white as snow. Oh, sing it for us, Leah. Words with us. Sing it with us. Oh, the blood.
Oh.
sing, there is healing. There is healing in the blood of Jesus. Sing it.
There is healing in the blood of Jesus. There is healing in the blood of Jesus. There is healing in the blood of Jesus. It washes.
Father, thank you for your blood that washes white as snow. Thank you for your sacrifice on Calvary. Thank you, God, that you've made us place here for us to worship you today. And thank you that you are here with us. I pray that you just move amongst us and do what you can only do during this time of worship. In Christ's name I pray, amen.
Well, amen. Hey, I forgot to announce a little earlier that today we're having our race car race back in the... You need to go back in the back and see the gym. Les and Rihanna have done it well. Yesterday, during the Auburn game, your pastor got in the flesh. And you can fit a 46-inch TV at a 36-inch window frame. But while I was sitting there, Landon was taunting. This is Anthony Tucker Jones. I call him Boudreaux. Was all that black hair, and I said, come here, Tucker, just a minute. I said, why don't you and I tonight go up to the church and get Landon's car? Landon's going to race against Tucker, and let's put some glue on the wheels. Did I say that?
Yes.
And you know what he told me? Paul, that'd be cheating. So thank God for grandkids to keep us straight. Yeah. And all the church said, go get you a seat, buddy, amen. Whew. I thought it'd been fun, but he said nothing. Hey, amen. Hey, turning your Bibles today to 2 Timothy chapter 1. We're continuing the study out of the book, Whatever Christian Ought to Know. And today we're dealing with the subject of blessed assurance. How can you have assurance? I just wrote something down in this progressive, liberal, looks like socially headed world, dangerous times that we live in. Adrian Rogers said, it is getting gloriously dark. Wow, that's a statement, isn't it? It's getting gloriously dark. So in our text today, and just let me give you a little backdrop before, and I'll show you this book in a moment. Before I read that, history tells us that at this point, when Paul penned these words, he's under house arrest in Rome, and he's facing certain death. All his associates and friends have faded into the background except one, and that was Luke. He was helping him. Paul was very concerned about the church and Timothy's welfare. Timothy was a very sickly guy, but also Timothy seemed to be extremely influenced by those people around him. And Paul, even though he's fixing to face death, was concerned about that. And so he gives us some text, some scripture today to help us in these uncertain moments. He made it very clear where and who his hope was in. This aged apostle, just listen, as this old man fixing to die shares his heart, his last moments, his last words that we're going to focus on today. So if you have your Bible, 2 Timothy chapter 1, I'm going to begin reading in verse 9, and I'm breaking in the conversation. I know that, but we just don't have time. So let's listen to what the aged apostle, fixing to face death, said to those of us who will live behind many of the things that he's facing, those difficult moments, those hard moments, those dangerous moments. Listen to what he said, verse 9. 2 Timothy, verse 1. the Lord who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, and all the church said, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now manifested by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ. And then he makes a great statement, who has abolished death and hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And then he claims, whereunto I'm appointed a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher to the Gentiles for this cause. Now I want you to listen to verse 12. This is our genesis. This is our thinking point this morning. For this cause which I also suffer these things. Literally in the context, he's saying, if I wasn't proclaiming the gospel like I am, I wouldn't be suffering the way that I am. But here's his point. I'm not going to quit telling people about Jesus, and if it means I have to suffer, so be it for the glory of God. And Paul said, and that's because that's the reason why I'm suffering these things. But notice what he says. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. Why, Paul? For I know in whom I have believed. And I am persuaded that he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. One of the greatest biblical statements of faith in the New Testament, in my opinion. Hold fast. Stay firm. Don't quit. Hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. So listen to this aged apostle as he's getting ready to face the executioners in those last moments. He's focusing in on this. I'm not, number one, he says, I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid. You don't believe that? Look at verse 12. For this cause I suffer these things. Paul said, I could easily end this just by being quiet, by denying the name of the Lord Jesus, but I'm not going to do that. I am not afraid. We live in some very uncertain, unprecedented times. But I want to say to those of us who are saved, been called by the grace of God in verse 9, that's what he said, who saved us and called us. Don't you listen to me. God who saved us is the same God who's going to keep us. And by the way, if God can't keep you, then how in the world can God save you? Amen? So this morning, the old song says, my hope is built on nothing less. I've said it a bunch, than Jesus' blood and righteousness. So Paul reminds us, he's not afraid. Listen to this, he says in the next phrase, not only am I not afraid, he says, I'm not ashamed. You know, I'm tired of backing up from the gospel message. I'm tired of saying, you know, the world is smart and intelligent. Listen to me, there's only one way to get out of this world by faith, and it's through Jesus Christ. I don't care what scheme they come up. I don't care what political truth they come up with. I don't care what social reformation. There's only one way you go into heaven, and his name is Jesus Christ. And it's by grace through faith. You cannot save yourselves. And this old apostle said, I want you to know where my faith is. I'm not afraid of them. I'm not ashamed. And so Paul makes his dying declaration. Here's something. In verse 13, Paul said, by all of this that's going around me, I'm unmoved. I'm staying right where I am because this is where God planted me. So I'll say to you this morning, don't be afraid, don't be ashamed, and don't be unmoved by the culture in which we live today. The New American Standard in verse 12 says, for where it says, I'm persuaded, it says, I'm convinced. Are you convinced today that the blood of Jesus can get you to where you're going? Not only that, when it says, I'm persuaded he's able to keep that, that word keep is a military term. It literally means God is guarding your divine commitment to him by faith. And listen to me, if anybody can hold on to it, it's the Lord. And all the church said, yes, I'm unafraid, I'm unashamed, I'm unmoved. Paul said, I'm holding fast, I'm staying where I am because of what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for me. And what he's doing through me. So in this world of darkness and discouragement, of doubt and deceit, there's one truth, one light that shines bright. And that's the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul said it this way, there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Paul could face death saying, I am convinced, I'm persuaded that Jesus is mine and I am his. I'm in him and he is in me. So here's my question to you this morning. How could the Apostle Paul have such confidence? How could he, in the face of such unrelenting persecution and hatred, say, I'm convinced that no matter what happens, God's going to keep that commitment that I made unto him? How in the world could he say that? Well, let me give you, I've got about 4 points. We're going to get through half of one today. So in your book, the second lesson or the second part, second chapter talks about blessed assurance. Hey, I meant to read this just a moment ago. I was asking the ladies. In 1969, an R&B singer named Stevie Wonder recorded a song named Sign, sealed, delivered. I'm yours. Hey, did you know you could almost say that about this passage? I think maybe Stevie got it from this. Signed, sealed, delivered, I'm yours. The song didn't come out till June the 3rd, 1970. Won his 6th Grammy Award, stayed on number one hit forever and ever and in eternity because of what it says. I just want you to know, listen carefully. As a Christian, in this unmitigated time, you can have blessed assurance. Doesn't come from within you. It doesn't come because you're a strong personality. It's because of three reasons. The first one is simply this. The first reason, I have absolute confidence because of the person who saved me. I want to read something here for you if I can. Do you see this up here? The person who saved me. Well, what does it mean to be saved? In your book, there's a great statement. It's on page 28. If you don't have the book, borrow somebody's or do a photo. You can take a camera out and take a picture of this. All right? This is pretty good. Let's read together. The person who saved me. The reason I have confidence is not because I've got great faith. It's because who saved me. It's not because I've just got a lot of convictions. It's because of who saved me. So let's read the Word of God. This is what he says. What does it mean to be saved? First, it means that every sin is forgiven and, thank God, been buried in the grave of God's forgetfulness. Whoo, aren't you glad he forgot? Thank God. That is a great statement. First reason I have confidence is because he saved me and he buried my sins in the grave of forgiveness. Second, it means that Jesus Christ, through the Holy Spirit, comes to live in us to give us peace, power, and I love this, and even a purpose. So to be saved means my sins are forgiven. To be saved means Christ has come to live inside of me. So any courage and conviction I have comes because of my relationship with him. But number third, it simply says this. It means when we die or when Jesus comes again, we're going home to heaven to be with him. What did Paul say? For I know in whom I have believed. And I am convinced, persuaded, that he's able to guard and to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Hey, he gives us three tests here. I'm going to share these real quickly. Then I've got three more that I want to give you. Number one. In your book, it talks about the commandment test. It's right there. Jesus said, if you love me, you will what? Keep my commandments. So if you're saved, the assurance that you have is based out of that relationship with Christ, that he's buried your sins, he's filled you with the Holy Spirit. It's this thing that I know I'm saved because of who Christ is in me. Here's a good one, the companion test. Jesus said, if you love me, you will love the brethren. You all right? Last week I said just because you don't like somebody's idiosyncrasies, because some of you weird people like onions in your potato salad. That's an idiosyncrasy. That's not I don't love you. That's just I don't like onions in my potato salad. So the Bible says when you get saved, you will have genuine compassion for the brethren. That's a companion test. How shall the world know you belong to me? How you love one another. That's a test. Hey, this is good, the confidence test. Hey, somebody sent me a question yesterday, and I'm going to try to best I can answer that. I know it gets scary right here. So Dr. Rogers said in his book that there's some people who don't know the date or the day that they got saved. So is it important that you remember the exact date or the exact day or time or where you were? Let me answer that with confidence. Remember, Paul said, I'm unafraid and what? Unashamed, and I'm unmoved. Some people are just better date keepers. I'm not a date person. Matter of fact, if you were to ask me when the service is over, Brother Ronnie, could you tell me your wife, son, daughter, 4 grandchildren's birthdays? I'd say no. I can get close. Matter of fact, if you'd ask me when my mother was born and when she died, I couldn't get you. I get you pretty close. Some people are a lot more date oriented than others. Now, I know that I was saved when I was 17. It was a Wednesday night because I went to church. Other than that, I don't know. I do know this. I knelt down a sinner, and I stood up a child of God. Amen. Transformed, changed, and different. Some people tend to be more date-oriented than other people are. People say, hey, Pastor, how long have you been married? Long time. Is that a good answer? I've been married so long, I ain't scared of nothing and nobody. Is that good? Some people just tend to be more date-oriented. So I do think you can be saved and not know. I don't know the exact date that I got saved on. I know it was a Wednesday. I know it was at church. I know I was a young man. But so some people are more. But the confidence comes from the fact that your life has been changed. That's important. Hey, I want to look at this idea of salvation. Back in your Bible, would you go to back to verse 9? Salvation is a gift received through grace by faith. We know that according to Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10. So the Bible says here, it's not according to my work, but his will. I'll say that again. Salvation is not according to my works. Now listen to me. Everybody got your ears open, your eyes? If you're saved, you will work. Because Jesus said, if you love me, you'll what? Keep my commandments. But I'm not saved because of what I've done. I'm saved because of who he is and what he has done. So read in your Bible. Matter of fact, we're going to go back to verse 6. We're in 2 Timothy 1:6. Look at this. Wherefore I put thee to remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God hath not given the spirit of fear, but of love and joy. And I'm reading out of the King James, sound mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor me his prisoner. Be thou partakers of the afflictions. If you have to suffer, then suffer. And then he says, who has saved us and who has called us. So there's a divine reckoning here. God sent his son into the world to save sinners. John 3:16, 17, and 18. So there is a truth here that gives us confidence. I didn't save me. He did. I didn't save me. He did. Now, did I walk down an aisle? Yeah, yes, because an aisle, not an owl, an aisle, because that's what I was asked to do. But at that time, I knelt down, and there was a transaction of faith that took place. I confessed I was a sinner. God broke my heart, crushed me, and by faith I reached out to him because he would, listen to me, he was already reaching down for me before I reached up to him. Amen. And that's good right there, by the way, just so you don't know. So the truth is, I didn't save myself. So brothers and sisters, if we did not save ourselves, we can trust in the one who did. He is the sovereign, saving, keeping Son of God. He has done it. He saved us, not the church, not the pastor, not Baptist. He saved us. So therefore, not only is the truth that he saved us, but I can trust in him because he said, all that you have given me, I have kept them, and I have not lost one. Do you remember the 99? Wow. So there's the truth factor. There's the trust factor. The one who saved me. I didn't save me. That means he is totally trustworthy. And Paul said, for I know in whom I have believed. I want to ask you, do you know in whom you have believed? I want to say this with all the love I can. I know some people trusting in their works. You going to heaven? Well, I hope so. Really? Really? That's all you have? Can I read your Bible? For I know in whom I have believed. Do you know in whom you believed? Have you trusted him? The truth is you can't save yourself. He saved you. So therefore the truth and the trust factor leads to a trustworthiness that Jesus Christ, Paul put his eternal soul in the safekeeping of the Lord Jesus. Why? Because he's fixing to die. And he says, I know in whom I have believed. And he's guarding that which I've committed unto him against that day. So when salvation is finished, you and I will be transformed into a likeness of him. Again, what does it mean to be saved? Christ has forgiven me my sins. He's buried them in the grave of forgetfulness. It means the Holy Spirit is now living. And really, probably, Pastor Keith, the word really is more he's operating in me. Not he's living in me, but he's operating in me to bring about God's divine will and sanctification in my life. But number three, that when I die, and by the way, last time I checked, you're going to die. You are. So with that in mind, the apostle said, the reason that I have confidence is not because I'm an apostle. It's not because the church, not because God's given me all this revelation. The reason I have confidence is because I know who saved me. And it wasn't me. Thank God it wasn't a preacher, nor a Baptist, nor a Pentecostal, nor anybody else. It was the Lord Jesus Christ. You and I need that. Every Christian needs the absolute assurance. Now, let me just stop here again. I promise you this, if anybody can make you doubt, it's the devil. He can stomp around in your mind. Well, you know, you don't remember the exact moment you got saved. You don't remember who was there. You don't remember, I had this. I don't remember what I said. I want you to listen to me carefully. God can read your heart better than your words. God knows your heart. I'm telling you, I didn't know there was an Old and New Testament. Y'all hear that? You know? I remember I went to Bible class. I thought the epistles were the apostles' wives. I pronounced Job as Job. That says Job. J-O-B, get a job. Am I with you? It says job. So I'm telling you, when I got saved, I was as ignorant biblically as you could be. All I knew was the Holy Spirit of God was pounding on my heart. Jesus Christ was knocking at the door of my heart. I said, Lord, I'm a sinner. I'm crushed, and I cried unto you, and I'm telling you, Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, stepped out of heaven and stepped into my heart, and he's been there ever since. I've been perfect. I write a book. But you see, I have confidence, not because I'm a Baptist preacher, not because I'm your pastor, not because we baptized several thousand people. I'm saved because I know in whom I have believed. I know I didn't save myself. I know that he's the one who saved me. So therefore, when I lay my head down at night, I can say I trust in the truth that Jesus Christ has transformed my life. Everybody all right? Good. That's good preaching, whether you know it or not. All right? The next reason I have assurance, not only because I know who saved me, the person, but because of the promise that once he saved me, he also sealed me. That's good. That may be better. No, they're close. Turn to Ephesians chapter 1. I want to prove everything I'm saying. Ephesians chapter 1. Not only is there the saving of a person, the Bible says there's the sealing. He not only saved me, the person, Jesus Christ, but the Bible says by the power of the Holy Spirit, he then sealed me. How many of y'all remember growing up and you used to can things in your house? Y'all remember that? Those old pressure cookers? Boy, that thing blew up on you. It'd kill everybody, wouldn't it? Y'all remember that? And you take those and put them in a, and you young people are going, what is he talking about? And you take those corn or green beans, you put them in those old ball jars, and that lid would go. Y'all remember that? That meant it was preserved, kept, it was sealed. All right? So when you got saved, listen, I believe in the 666 mark of the Antichrist, but I also believe in the seal of the Holy Spirit. And by the way, I'd rather trust the seal of the Holy Spirit. It's a lot stronger than the mark of the beast. Amen? So not only the person who saved me, but the promise that when I got saved, he then sealed me. Let's read it together in your Bible. I'm in, where am I at? I'm in Ephesians chapter 1. Let's look in verse 13. In whom you also trusted. You know, there's the truth and trust. I just mentioned that. Got it? The truth is he saved me, then I can trust him. Now, know what he says. In whom also you trusted that after you heard the word of truth. So here it is. He's got his facts in line. You hear the word. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So here he says, when you heard the word of God, the Holy Spirit pricked your heart, moved upon your spirit, brought you under divine conviction, in whom you trusted after that you heard the word. You heard the word first, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also that after you believed, saved, notice this, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of, would you say that last word out loud? Oh, come on, say it loud now. Promise. What's the promise? I'll never leave thee. I'll never lose you. I'm going to tell you and I are standing on pretty good ground today. Not only because of the person who saved us, but because of the promise that when he did save us, he then, by the grace and power of God, sealed us. In the Greek, that word means finished transaction. Literally what it says, when he sealed you, it was finished. When Jesus was on the cross, he said, Tetelestai, it is done. Finished. Sealed. Praise God. Can't get any better. Nothing more to do. It's already all been done. When important documents are done, most of the time they're stamped with some type of official seal that signifies the transaction has been completed by both parties. And the Bible says that when you and I got saved, God finished the transaction of salvation, not because you saved you or I saved me, but because he saved me. And when he saved me, he sealed me with the Holy Spirit. Man, That's a big point right there. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. Satan can't get through the blood. He may get in my mind and my heart and prance around and do a lot of things, but I'm going to tell you, he cannot break the blood covenant that I have with my Father. You understand? He may even cause me to doubt it, but he can't break it. Somebody said, well, Ephesians 6 says you can lose your salvation. That's really not my, I'll maybe get into that next week, eternal security, or 2 weeks, and maybe three, because this is good. At what point do you stop being saved? What sin do you sin that cancels out the blood covenant of the Lord Jesus Christ? I remember my sister went to a particular, and I won't get into all that, but you couldn't go to the movies. If you went to the movie, it was a sin, and you were lost. You can't go watch John Wayne movies. That was what was on the screen, young people, when I was little. John Wayne, Dean Martin. And I got kind of ugly with her. I said, so I want to ask you a question. So if I go into the movies and I step halfway in the door and stop, am I half saved and half lost? More lost, less lost? Y'all see what I'm saying? And I didn't mean to be ugly with her, but she said, you know, if you go in that movie house, you're lost. I said, really? Y'all with me? Would you please show me that in the Bible? Now, I can get up here and get all the emotions stirred up. And by the way, let me go back and reiterate a point. About 20 years ago, Pastor, you probably remember this, evangelists were real big on making you think you were lost if you didn't know the date and time so you'd get resaved. I don't mean to be ugly there, but they were looking for numbers. If they get you, doubt your salvation, here's what they say. Well, if you doubt it, won't you just come down and get resaved again? And he'd go tell his buddies, I had 35 people saved last week. I don't mean to be ugly there, but I saw it happen. So not only the person who saved me, but the promise that when I got saved, he officially stamped me, sealed me with the Holy Spirit. There's three words here, finality. Finality. There's the witness of the Holy Spirit. He's still working on me to make me what ought to be. So there's the finality, this transaction, the witness of the Holy Spirit. He's mine and I'm his. When Jesus breathed his last breath, he declared, Father, it is done. Literally, it's finished. The work that you sent me to do is finished. And then this, period. So when you got saved, final transaction. Now listen to me. Does that mean you're perfected? No. But it means you are saved, sealed, period. And you're moving on in the grace of God. So the Lord Jesus saved you and then he sealed you. He said, it's finished, paid in full. What's that old song, All to Him I Owe? So why? Because of what he's done. So 2 Timothy reminds us, he saved us. He called us with the holy calling. It's not ours. It's him who works in us. And in verse 13 of Ephesians chapter 1, he reminds us, would you read that again? In whom you also trusted. Now remember the word trust in the Greek Aramaic is a little bit different than the word belief in English. Let me give you I've given the illustration before. I've seen people get in an airplane and jump out with a parachute on. Really? I just want to know how big was the gun the person holding behind them, because that's the only way I'm going. Now listen to me. I think it would be fun once I jumped. There'd be 32 aneurysms and 42 heart attacks before. But I really believe if I had a parachute on, I walked up to the door, hundreds and thousands of people. Anybody here parachuted? Raise your hand. Boy, we got some crazy people. A woman? Marie? Did you jump out of a plane? Good. Glory to God. Man, I'm impressed. Now here's my point. I believe it would work. I believe if I got on the plane, strapped it on, stepped out, I believe somewhere in God's economy it'd work out, but I don't trust it enough to do it. You with me? So there's a difference between belief and trust. So Paul didn't say, I know in whom I believe. In the Greek, it literally would say, I know in whom I have trusted. I've committed my life to. I know that he's going to take me to heaven because he saved me, and I didn't save myself. And so it is the grace of God. So we have the seal, the witness of the Holy Spirit. Number two, I like this. You have the work of the Savior. The work of the Savior. Would you turn to Ephesians 2? We're going to have to stop right here. We got another little order of business. Turn to Ephesians 2 real quick. So not only is there the witness of the Spirit, the work of the Savior, there's my walk in Scripture. We don't have time to get to that. Turn to Ephesians 2, and then we've got to wrap it up. Real quick, like. So know what's Ephesians 2, the promise that sealed me, the person who saved me. Hey, I hope you're reading the book. I'm promise. I want y'all to listen to me. There is some phenomenal stuff in that book. It's a devotion. You need to read it. Again, I'm just not trying to reduplicate it up here. I could. By the way, I meant to tell you, you say, well, hey, Pastor, I just need some assurance. Dr. Warren Wiersbe wrote a little book, Encouragement for Difficult Days, The Bumps You Climb On. That's not in print anymore, but if you would like a copy, I think I know where I can get some. You say, man, right now my faith is really being challenged. The devil really having a field day. And maybe you just need some divine reminders of who you are. So with that in mind, not only the person who saved me, but the promise that he sealed me. So look in your Bible. We're going to begin reading in verse 5, Ephesians 2. Even when we were dead in sins, he has quickened us. That word quickened means he made you alive together with Christ. By grace you're saved. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Why did he do that? So that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness. Do you see that word kindness? Toward us. And then he says this, and I know verse 8, but I'm going to work through verse 8. For by grace you save through faith, that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God. You didn't do it, he did. Not of works, lest I could brag. Verse 10, for we are his workmanship. When you go out into the gym today, I've already been back there. There's some beautiful stuff back there. But all these little boys and girls have worked on their car. And there's a little bit of individuality on each car probably. Now, we know Daddy probably did a lot of it. Hey, we understand. But every car was kind of done differently because every little boy wanted to do something to it a little different. I like a red one. I like a white one. And add weight. Take off. And so they worked on their cars to the specifications they wanted to be. Did you know God made you the way you are because that's the way he wanted you to be? Did y'all hear that? I don't think I could say it again, so I hope you got it. Because it's not in my notes. But we're his workmanship created in Christ. Why? Under good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, I'm a purchase of God. Are you? If you are, you can go to sleep tonight with the world falling apart and have blessed assurance. Sweet assurance. We live in a crazy world. You need it today. All right? Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Father, in this moment, may he, the power of the Holy Spirit, come and speak to our lives. And God, I'm aware that there's some people in this room today, they're going through difficulties, they're struggling. And I'm thankful that the Holy Spirit is here to give us confidence. And the reason I have confidence, Paul says, not because I didn't save me. Judaism didn't save me. Being a Pharisee didn't save me. Being a Roman didn't save me. One day I was on a road, bright light. And Jesus said, Paul, I love you. And by faith, Paul trusted Christ. And in those last moments, just before they took his life, Paul said, I know who I have believed. And I am convinced he's going to take care of me. If you don't have that today, you can. I'm not preaching this to make you doubt your salvation. I'm preaching this to give you assurance that if you've committed your faith, and your trust in Christ, he's going to take care of you. All to Jesus, I surrender. There's the work of the Holy Spirit, the witness, and then there's the fact that Christ is working in my life. Just a few moments longer. Remind you that when the service is over, if you just need to have a private conversation, we can step in a room and we can just share our heart. Father, thank you for grace and mercy that produces assurance. So, Lord, as we walk through this difficult, dark world, thank you that, God, our faith holds. It's real. It gives us that divine assurance that no matter what happens, the Lord is with us. So, Father, in this time today, have your will and have your way. For us, in Jesus' name we pray. And all the church said, well, amen, amen. Hey, if you would, for just a moment, I'm going to ask Brother Chris Hunt to come forward. And we were supposed to, I'm going to read something for you here after he does this. But Louis Kennar is one of the young men serving in our church. Louis, are you in the room yet? Would you and your wife just come stand kind of right here, if you don't mind? If she will. Amen. And I'll let him introduce family. And Ron, where are you at? Brother Ron? Kids. Hey, do the girls mind coming? Y'all, we don't want to embarrass you, but we want you to know who these people are. Lewis was voted on almost 2 years ago in the deacon body. I thought we had done a church vote, so my mistake. And so we're ready to ordain him and his family into the ministry of being a deacon. Ron has already been ordained. He has served in another church, and so we want to make him what's called an active deacon here in the life of our church. So to do that, again, with COVID, we just hadn't had any services, any business meetings. So we just need to officially do that. So we want you to know who they are. So Chris, you talk to them a little bit.
Before I do, could I get all the deacons we got in the room, active and not active, to stand up for a second? This group of men, I've been humbled to be associated with them for several years now, and it's been a blessing. You look around and you see all the different personalities y'all can have a seat. Y'all just thank them and thank them for what they
yes.
do in the church. It's humbling to serve with them. It takes all different kinds, and that's an awesome thing. Lewis here, I've known him, I guess, since he was 18. We were separate for a while. Ron, I've known him, I guess, since we've been coming to church here. It's been a day or two. But I'll tell you something that my wife pointed out to me as well. I've spent a lot of time around their kids.
Yeah.
And if you want to know someone, spend some time around their children and see how they look at life and how they respond in life. And it's a humbling thing to watch. These are two great families. We're humbled to have them. Everyone in here was in one accord as far as the deacons on bringing these two forward to serve with us. And we pray to have them beside us for many years.
And but before they sit down, I just want to read a few verses. Let me remind you, one of the difficulties of Pastor and Center Star is we're not a local church, we're a regional church. We have families here from Elgin, Lexington, Rogersville, Town Creek, Florence. And so I know it's, you say, well, I don't know who they are. I understand that's the last 30 years we've had that because we're not a local. It's not, it used to be a little family church. It's not anymore. And so it's hard to know everybody here. Hey, I love you. I'm your pastor. Brother, sister, I want to say clearly, these two guys received 100% vote. We bring up different names from different times, and they have the full confidence of the deacon body, and I fully would say amen. Let me read a few verses. These are supposed to be on the screen, and due to the situation this week, I forgot. Likewise, must the deacons be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, greedy, filthy lucre. They hold the mystery of faith in a pure conscience. Let these be proved, and they have been, and then let them use the office of deacons, being found blameless. Even so, their wives must be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. Let the deacons be the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their houses well. For they that have used the office of a deacon well purchase to themselves a good degree, great boldness in the faith, which is in Christ Jesus. And there's a few others, but that gets it. So here's what's going to happen. Next week, when you come in, you'll be given a little piece of paper. I want to ask you to vote, and then those will be turned into the deacons. We voted last week to change the process a little bit of 10%, needed 80% approval of the church family to go forward. And if that happens, then the end of October, we'll have an ordination service for Louis Kennar, okay? So if you have any questions, please see one of the deacons or see myself. Again, I apologize about that. I thought we'd already done all this, and so this is on me. So please forgive me. Move forward. Hey, I just want to say something right here. Y'all listen to my heart. I thank God for our deacons. I lean on them heavy. With COVID and everything, I mean, there were times I went in there and said, guys, I don't know what to do. Y'all please help us. So thank God for these men. They don't have to do this. They do it as a service to the Lord in the local body of the church. And I'm just telling you, thank God for our deacons. So, hey, meet these people when you can and let them know you're praying for them and ask the Lord to bless them. So next Sunday we'll vote and then we'll move forward, okay? Everybody all right? All right. So what did y'all just do? Something big, all right? So, hey, let's praise the church family. Hey, let me again remind you that this afternoon starting at 2, there will be the rookies versus the experts. They got a track set up. I wish we had a picture. The gym is pretty awesome. Race cars are back there. So if you get a chance to come back by, you ought to do that. I think they're going to have some refreshments, a sale to help raise some money for stuff. And so we hope next year this may even grow bigger. We may do some other stuff with this, okay? So, hey, remind you, thank you for your faithfulness to give as you leave the room today. And the offering plates are there as you faithfully give. Let's pray together. Father, I want to thank you for these two families, for the Canars and the Halls and the sacrifices and the commitments they've made. They didn't have to. They did it because they love you. And I thank you for them and their witness. Lord, would you bless them here as they serve among this church body. We thank you for the men and women who have faithfully done that through the years. So, Lord, we give you glory for them. And, Father, I want to pray again for anybody in the room who may be struggling with their faith and the conscience that may be stinging. I pray that, God, you'd give them assurance that they know that they have been saved and that, Lord, the Holy Spirit has sealed them and that the Savior is working in their life. We thank you for all you've done, all you're going to do in Jesus' name. And all the church family said, amen. Have a good afternoon in the Lord. Pray for him.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.